Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Annie Wells is joining us remotely today and Mark Griffin will be with us shortly. May I remind members to and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
We're all agreed. Thank you. Now we turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the planning data parts of the UK Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill's legislative consent memorandum from Tom Arthur, who's the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. And Mr. Arthur is accompanied today by Scottish Government officials, Cara Davidson, who is the Head of Environment and Energy, and Liz Pringle, who's the Head of Digital Planning Services. And I welcome Mr. Arthur to the meeting. Before I open the session to questions from members, I'd like to invite you to make a short opening statement.
Well, good morning to the committee and thank you to you, convener, for the invitation and opportunity to address the committee on the UK Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill. We are talking this morning specifically about the planning data provisions in Chapter 1 of Part 3, and I am conscious that the committee has recently heard evidence from key stakeholders. Before turning to Part 3 in detail, I want to reiterate the Scottish Government's fundamental concerns about this bill. As you will know, we have recommended that the Scottish Parliament does not provide legislative consent for this bill as currently drafted, given its absolute threat to a wide range of devolved responsibilities and failure to respect this Parliament and the Scottish Government's roles in legislating for devolved powers. And we remain concerned that the Westminster Government will ignore our collective role and simply legislate without our consent. Turning to Part 3, I am not surprised that the evidence that you have heard to date has pointed to a lack of information on how planning data provisions in the UK Bill will operate in practice. I'd like to set on record my frustration that we received little advanced sight of the draft bill before its introduction. This lack of meaningful prior engagement from the UK Government is sadly all too typical of their current approach to legislation. And it contrasts with our own work in Scotland on the Digital Planning Strategy and Transformation Programme and on our collaborative approach to planning reform as a whole. So whilst I recognise and support the need for planning data standards in principle, the lack of detail on how these provisions will be implemented leave unanswered questions. With so many unknowns, there is also potential for conflict with the work already been undertaken in Scotland as part of our Digital Planning Transformation Programme, a £35 million capital investment initiative already underway. This is an ambitious programme led by the Scottish Government, working in partnership across the public sector. It will put data and new digital technologies at the heart of Scotland's planning system, helping achieve wider planning reform aims to deliver an open, streamlined and inclusive planning system fit for the future. Our work in this programme is making real progress, with the first new digital services expected to be rolled out next year. We are building these new digital services and products upon solid data and technical foundations, working in collaboration with our partners. You heard that last week's evidence session, the strong support we have from stakeholders for the direction and the approach we are taking, one of collaboration across the sector, rather than mandating a way forward. In Scotland, we are taking a comprehensive approach to improving planning data. Our data strategy will set out a roadmap to provide easy access to high-quality data for use across planning and place-based working. I therefore have real concerns about the UK Government's intention to legislate in areas of devolved and executively devolved competence without any real knowledge of what we are doing in Scotland, nor any interest in accommodating that in the bill. We could find ourselves in the unhelpful situation of having Scottish planning authorities subject to conflicting measures, one imposed on them through a UK bill, the other agreed through mutual collaboration to improve our planning system in line with our own domestic legislation and priorities. Part 3, as currently drafted, provides one of many reasons why the Scottish Government cannot recommend that the Scottish Parliament gives consent to these provisions as they stand. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much for that statement. And yes, it was good to hear last week about the the Scottish Digital Transformation project, and it's also good to hear from yourself right now that it's going to be rolled out next year. So I'm going to open up the session to questions, and I'm going to get started with the first question, which is, what, if any, engagement did you or the Scottish Government planning officials have with the UK Government on the issue of planning data prior to the introduction of the Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill in the UK Parliament? And you've indicated there had been a lack of consultation or collaboration in a way, but I'm also kind of interested in, you know, was there ever any work done even before this bill was even considered?
Well, as I said, there obviously has been dialogue between relevant officials in both governments on the bill provisions. However, as with other aspects of the bill, there remains a lack of data as to how planning data provisions will be implemented. The reality is that the clauses as introduced give unlimited scope for UK ministers to regulate in areas of devolved and executively devolved competence for Scotland. And its crucial point is it's the requirement is only for consultation, not consent, not agreement, only consultation. And I think we've seen over recent years what that means in practice from the UK government, given how willing they are have been to ride roughshod over the Steel Convention. So the reality is that this does pose a threat. There hasn't been the detailed consultation. There's lack of clarity on the details. And I think in terms of moving forward, a very minimum, and I say this is just a starting point, we have to move from a position of consultation to one of consent and one that does not impact upon the competencies of ministers and indeed of this Parliament.
Thanks for that. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs with a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to ask, we've heard from the evidence which we've been taking on this in the limited time we've had to speak to stakeholders that planning stakeholders here in Scotland have told the committee they're unclear around the term planning data. What do you think planning data is? And do you think this demonstrates the fact that there's gaps in data in our planning system in Scotland?
Well, the first point I'm making, I'll maybe ask Liz to come in on this in a moment, is within our strategy, digital strategy for planning, one of the key missions is data. And I think we would all recognise the importance of data more widely. I know the Audit Scotland has got, you know, released out this morning on the importance of data and policy design. So that's something we would recognise. With regards to what the bill does in terms of the definition, and what it means in practice, it's set out at Clause 75.2, and it says planning data is said to include any information provided to or processed by a planning authority for the purposes of a function under a relevant planning enactment. A relevant planning enactment would include any enactment made by the Secretary of State under Part 5 of the Bill, which applies UK-wide and contains provisions on environmental outcome regulations. Now, there's also a lack of information on how provisions on the EORs would operate, and that combined with a lack of detail on implementation and practice for planning data provisions means that it is unclear what the wider implications would be for the handling of planning data in Scotland. And that speaks to the point I'm making just about the uncertainty and vagueness that comes with this. But I think in terms of broadly what we're doing around planning data, its importance, and to maybe give some examples, I'll ask Liz if she wants to come in.
Thank you, Minister. And yes, I would agree. I think that there is a lack of detail around the definition of planning data. We have heard as we've been developing the digital strategy about the vast amount of data that could be used within the planning system and the impact of not having that in a high-quality, well-managed fashion and the impact for our planning authority stakeholders in terms of the amount of time and effort that's taken to, for example, find and access data for preparing local development plans, and you know that's one single area where the kind of lack of consistency and data quality impacts the planning system. And the work that we are doing is trying to look across the planning system at the needs of planning data, what they are, and how we make sure that we reach a sustainable model for managing that data in a comprehensive way going forward.
Mm-hmm. That's helpful, thank you. And I think we heard last week, I can't remember who gave us this evidence, but with regards to there being a one IT platform which this would be hosted on. So I think that maybe presents an opportunity that that data can be therefore shared and accessed across UK and Scottish government and all local authorities being able to share that. I wanted to ask, though, looking towards what this can potentially provide benefits around, would you agree that planning data is something that would benefit from processing at a GB-wide level, that that data could be compatible?
I think what is important to recognise is the approach that we are taking in Scotland is one of genuine collaboration, which I think is vital if we want to get the most out of planning and fully realise planning's potential to deliver across so many areas. So the risk and the concern is that there's conflict here. Planning has always been effectively a devolved competence in over 75 years of the Town and Country Planning Acts. Memory serves me right, but has always been a distinct Scottish Planning Act. I think the one time they tried to go and combine them in the 1950s, it became a bit of a mess and they had to separate them again. So that's always been the nature of planning. It is a devolved competence and it is for this Parliament to take an approach. Now, if the UK government wants to engage constructively and recognise the competences of this Parliament and not seek to act in a way that can legislate without the agreement of this Parliament, of course, very happy to engage and, of course, recognise the value of having a consistency of approach across Scotland, which is something we are working towards through our broader work on digital transformation within planning. But I think the key issue here is this cannot be something that is mandated from a UK government that is somewhat distant from the reality of the work we're doing in planning in Scotland. We have to have the space to continue what we're doing, which is to develop an approach in collaboration with planning authorities and other partners.
OK, thanks for that. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. And I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I mean, this is a potential dog's breakfast, isn't it? The Scottish Government's already embarked on its digital strategy and have given us an indication of progress so far. My own experience of East Ayrshire Council's digital planning system, it's really good. It's really robust. Members of the public can access it. They can see decision processes. They can see documents, maps, drawings, everything. It's really well advanced, and I hope that our system will take that further. But my question to you, Minister, is if the UK is legislating on this, is it ultimately possible that our authorities could be acting illegally doing what they're doing?
I can't comment on that specifically, but I did touch in my opening remarks and the risk of confusion if we have a process where we're developing an approach in collaboration with planning authorities in Scotland, and then we have the UK government mandating something UK-wide. That is, as you described it, you know, a recipe for a dog's breakfast, but you know, in one sense, at the very least, it can create confusion, and it's not an efficient way to go about doing things. As I say, the reality is the one of the benefits that devolution confers, is, and we all know this from our kind of experience as constituency and regional representatives, is that we can be far more responsive and attuned to the particular circumstances of the places and localities we represent. And so with government and how we sort of design or devolve public services, and within planning, we have a collaborative approach built on, you know, deep and sustained engagement. That is what has informed a whole range of work that we're taking forward in planning reform, and it equally informs how we're taking forward our approach around the digital. I don't know, Liz, if you maybe want to talk about some of the sort of partnership working that takes place and how we engage in developing our approach to digital planning.
Yes, Minister, thanks. Well, the digital strategy itself was a collaborative strategy. We spent a significant amount of time working with our stakeholders to agree the priorities that went into that strategy. So we knew that we had the support as the strategy was published, and subsequently as the transformation programme is being delivered, it's very much a partnership between ourselves and public sector colleagues, where through the working groups and the projects that are being delivered, we're working in collaboration with all of the stakeholders to make sure that what's being delivered fits the needs of each of our stakeholder groups, and we're not developing things that are contrary to the needs.
So I would just highlight that approach that Liz has just very eloquently articulated, with having a provision bounced on us in a bill from the UK government. It's the approach that the UK government has taken is not consistent with that collaborative spirit. It is ignoring the reality of devolution, and it ultimately has the potential to, at the very least, cause confusion, but ultimately to significantly undermine and frustrate our ambitions, our shared ambitions that we're working towards on a collaborative basis.
Has the UK even sought to find out what the Scottish Government is doing in this area, the digital strategy, for example, so that they can it can help them shape whatever it is they're planning to do? Has there been any engagement to that degree, at least, so they understand what we're doing?
There's certainly not been directly at the ministerial level. May I maybe ask Elizabeth what engagement there's been with UK counterparts at official level?
We do have dialogue with our counterparts on the broader digital programmes that are taking place, but as we've said previously, not on the detail of the planning data provisions.
Okay, thank you. My other question was really about the issue you mentioned again, Minister. This is not a consent process, this is just a consultative process, isn't it? It's not even asking the Parliament, this Parliament, for consent to this proposal. What are your views on that principle of consent not being sought?
It's, well, the Scottish Government's position is very clear in this. We're completely opposed to it. And the reality is, from the UK Government, even the word consent took on a perverse meaning in the context of legislation pertaining to Brexit. If you remember, around consent decisions, and it's a definition that was applied to that. The reality is that there are clear devolved competencies, and indeed the relevant sections of the bill, I think from memory, section 80, recognise that. The reality is that, you know, ministers are happy to engage with the UK government on any issues and discuss areas of shared interest, and there's other forums in which, you know, I engage with ministerial counterparts on a range of different issues. For example, through the British Irish Council, I was took part in discussions on spatial planning. I've had discussions on areas of social enterprise and such like. And that is productive, collaborative engagement where we can share experiences based upon mutual respect. What we have there is the UK government seeking through legislation to effectively undermine devolution and go against the spirit of it. And the reality is, we are now 25 years on from the referendum that established this Parliament, and as the Scottish Social Attitude Survey data published recently shows, that the clear majority of people in Scotland, we trust this institution, we trust the institution of Scottish Government, they want this institution to be having the lion's share of decision-making that impacts upon their daily life. There is no popular support, there is no mandate, you know, political or otherwise, to see these powers removed or undermined from the Scottish Parliament. So what the UK government, in my opinion, the government have to do, if they're going to be, you know, talking about having a respect agenda or such like, then that needs to be shown in action and not just words. And the reality is that there are clear areas in the Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill which fall within devolved competence. And UK ministers should not be seeking to, you know, grant themselves power to start legislating in devolved areas without the express agreement of this Parliament, which they do not have.
So this process that we're in at the moment doesn't even get to the dizzy heights of a consent decision?
No, it doesn't. It's consultation. And consultation can exist across a broad spectrum, from something that is very deep and meaningful to something that is a superficial tick box exercise. And the reality is that, given that the lack of consultation in advance of this bill, the lack of detail, that does not bode well for how, you know, UK ministers would intend to consult going forward if this bill becomes an act as it is currently drafted.
Okay, thank you for that, Minister. Other members have questions, I'm sure.
Thanks, Willie. Yes, I'm going to bring in Paul McClellan.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Minister. Last week, I think what was very noticeable was from stakeholders was they weren't sure what the bill was about either, and that came through. But one of the things that we got in the evidence coming through last week was in regards to the UK Minister. Apparently, has written to the Scottish Parliament's Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee on the 25th of October, indicating constructive discussions had taken place with Scottish Government officials. And also mentioned about committed to bringing forward amendments to the bill to ensure it reflects what has been agreed with the Scottish Government. From obviously what you're saying just now, that doesn't seem to be the case. I don't know if you want to elaborate on that or touch on that at all. It just doesn't seem to be coming through in what we've picked up.
I'll ask Cara to come in here.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we certainly at official level have ongoing dialogue with UK government officials, and certainly we have heard both at official level and from UK ministers that there is a commitment to amending the devolution clauses that you see on the face of the bill at the moment. However, so far we have not had any proposals on what replacement clauses would look like, and we have not had a sight of any drafting, which is obviously a concern, and certainly the timetable for the bill remains a little bit of an unknown, and it continues to make its way through Parliament, as you know.
So, I mean, I have to say, I'm going to share the concerns. I think that Willie Coffey had mentioned earlier, you know, we've got a bill that's passing through that stakeholders don't know about, and Scottish Government doesn't seem to know about amendments either. Minister, I don't know if you want to say anything else, and I think the evidence we're hearing so far, for me, you know, says enough in terms of this. It's a bill that's passing through without any proper consultation with government, with stakeholders. And we've already, I think you've already indicated about what Scottish Government's doing in terms of planning, printing about data and digital planning.
Yeah, it's just that our whole approach towards planning and indeed regeneration and community wealth building is about collaboration, about engagement. It's recognising that to, you know, achieve the outcomes that we want to see, no one body, no one agency can do it all alone. We need to work together, and that's very important when designing policy. The UK government's approach doesn't seem to be like that. I mean, the levelling up agenda seems more like a soundbite that's now chasing, you know, trying to invent a policy programme to justify itself. And as I say, you know, if there is a genuine desire from the UK government to engage seriously on these issues and with respect to the competences of this Parliament and Scottish ministers, of course, happy to engage that is a responsible thing to do. But I think, as has been narrated this morning and as you will have inferred from the contributions from stakeholders last week, that has not been the approach that the UK government has undertaken.
Okay. Thanks, Minister. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks, Paul. I just wanted to ask a little bit more on that. So, Cara, you mentioned these amendments that would come, and that we're in a bit of a mystery about what they will be and when they will come. But from our perspective, I'd be interested to hear what role the Scottish Parliament would have in scrutinising any of the outputs of the discussions that you've been having.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's fair to say that discussions at official level at the moment have not brought forward any more information other than what we have on the face of the bill, essentially. And, you know, it's only possible for us to comment at the moment on what is in the bill as it is before the UK Parliament as things stand. The process itself remains unknown, and the timetable for further meaningful proposals coming forward is also an unknown. You'll be aware that Mr. Matheson wrote on the 14th of October to the UK government, and we await a response to that letter.
Okay, thanks very much. And now Mark Griffin, final question.
Thank you, Convener. Apologies for arriving late, Convener and Minister, and if you've covered this in your opening statement, I apologise as well. The committee understands that the revised draft of MPF4 is due to be laid shortly, and I just wondered if there had been any analysis of any impact this UK legislation has on that National Plan Framework 4, and if that would have any impact on timescale for approving.
There's nothing at this stage. I suppose I'd have to go back to the point about the degree of uncertainty, which makes it difficult to come to a rounded judgment. At this stage, I don't think there would be any direct impact on NPF4, and certainly not in the timescales for Parliament to consider. Looking beyond that, in terms of implementation and delivery, data is, of course, we're discussing an exceptionally important part of the planning process. So any impacts upon data could have an indirect impact upon delivery in NPF4, but I don't want to indulge too much in speculation, because ultimately we don't have the clarity from the UK government to come to, as I say, a fully informed view on that. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to...
Nothing to add.
No.
And, And similarly then, I guess we're just asking to speculate again whether that has any impact then on local authorities' local development plans that follow on from NPF4?
Well, I think the point touched on earlier, the risk that we have is through our work on digital and planning is we're taking this collaborative approach, working together. If we have a situation where the UK government is mandating something else, then clearly that creates the possibility or the likelihood even of conflict and confusion, which characterises much of the whole levelling up agenda, because it is trespassing into devolved competencies. So I think that, yes, there is a potential risk, but in terms of being able to properly quantify what that risk actually is, until such times as we have clarity around A, what the UK government's intentions are around planning data, and B, what any potential amendments might be with regards to how it would impact upon Scotland, at this stage it is just simply too early to tell.
Okay, thanks, Minister.
Thanks, Mark. And that concludes our questions. So thanks so much for giving evidence today along with your officials. And we're now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. The third item on our agenda today is to take evidence on understanding barriers to local elected office. And we have two panels of witnesses joining us and are joined remotely for our first session by Jesse Duncan, who's the Development Officer from Engender. Welcome. Hannah Stevens, who's the Chief Executive of Elect Her. And Talat Yaqub, who is the consultant and the co-founder of Women 50-50. And I welcome you warmly to our meeting. And we will direct questions to specific witnesses where possible. But if any of you wish to make a contribution, please type R in the chat function and the clerks will let me know. And I'll now open the session by asking a few questions myself. So I'd like to begin by taking a broader look over the last 10 years. And I'm going to direct this initially to Hannah. Given the effort and will evident over the past 10 years, do you have a sense of why there's such a slow pace of improvement in the number of female councillors in Scotland?
I think at this point we can say there's effort and will, but we haven't seen enough action from all the different members that have the power to make fundamental change in this area. There are so many challenges that women face in getting involved and from the very, very early stages of their political journey right through to getting more engaged and making a choice to stand for elected office. There's barriers every single stage of that pipeline. And then, as we've seen more recently, once women are elected, we do not have the conditions in which they can thrive. So therefore, we're starting to understand that there's a retention issue at the other end of that pipeline. So we need to be putting in mechanisms at every single stage of that. And that comes down to councils, authorities, political parties and the government all have a role to play in shifting the culture and creating the conditions where women can thrive in this role.
Thank you. And would anyone else like to come in on that? You don't have to, just want to give that space. Yeah, Jesse.
Hi, yeah, thanks. I think the key thing to that we have tried to get across with this campaign that we've launched recently, the Making It Happen for 2027 campaign, that our three organisations have come together to try and put this issue of the kind of perennial low levels of women in local government in the spotlight, because this is an issue that just is kind of like we're having deja vu after every local election, and the rate of increase for women in local government is climbing so slowly. Like Hannah was saying rightly, like it's a combination of factors. It's a really kind of complex and interlinked issue. And there's structural changes that need to be made. There's cultural changes that need to be made. Really kind of concrete things that there's been kind of little movement on. Things like the very low level of pay comparative to the increasing pressures and duties that are involved in the role. Issues like the increasing visibility of women councillors in the role and kind of concerns around safeguarding and concerns around things like abuse and inadequate processes to safeguard against that, inadequate complaints procedures, both within within parties, within councils, within kind of structures themselves. I think that there's like a kind of the consistently low level of women within councils as well means that the system doesn't have the impetus to change, or it hasn't had the impetus to change. So it kind of becomes like a cyclical problem. So it's really important to kind of view the issue holistically in the round and not wait for women to enter these spaces to bring about that change, but to create the conditions that are going to enable them to enter and to thrive, like Hannah was saying. And I'm sure we'll get into some of those issues in a bit more detail.
Thanks, Jesse. And Talat, you want to come in as well?
Yes, thank you. Good morning. To endorse what has been said by Hannah and Jesse already, it's no surprise that we'll agree on those points. But there's a few things. Women 50-50 is in that time to advocate for candidate quotas. And is that we are still in a...
Your audio is intermittent, so if you could just pause for a moment and... What do we need to do about that?
Yeah, we're going to try and turn the camera off, just do an audio only.
Okay. So we're going to look at turning your camera off and just having you audio just to make sure we hear everything you say. Okay, would you like to start again?
No problem. Sorry about that.
No, technology is not you.
Hopefully that's working okay. Just to... Women 50, and it's pursuing candidate quotas. And the reason for this is because what we find is a real lack of accountability. There's perhaps some political will, but what we see is a scramble for numbers to show diversity of candidates a matter of mere months before an election takes place, rather than the long-term investment and development and working with communities that politics should be focused on. There isn't the accountability mechanisms, whether that is with political parties, within council structures and democratic measures within the system, or within political parties. So what we see is a scramble for numbers and diverse candidates. So the focus is on numbers, and the focus is on reputational damage if there isn't diverse candidates, but not the culture that actually allows candidates to thrive and want to participate in politics. The second that we haven't seen enough on is those who are from the most marginalised community. So the intersecting inequalities of sexism and racism, of ableism, of classism. We don't have enough efforts on understanding that those who experience multiple discriminations are not participating in politics. And until we do that, we will not see a fair representation of our diverse communities within Scotland's local councils.
Thanks for that. And just picking up on that bit about representation, do you think that young women, young people in general, face further barriers to standing for office?
Yes, I do. And I think part of the reason for that is because our politics is our politics and our local government certainly is not working at the community level. So outreach, participation in politics, participation in local democracy that would encourage young people to see candidacy, to see local government as something that they may want to aspire to, may want to run for, requires outreach, engagement and community participation that is beyond simply elections. What we need is politics that is closer to people, closer to communities, where people feel they have a stake in decision making. The more we have of that, the more marginalised communities and, yes, indeed, young people and young women will feel like council is something that is relevant to them.
Thanks very much for that. I'm just going to move on to another question, which is about the future. And Jessie, I'm going to direct this to you initially, but everybody is welcome to contribute. What would you like to see happen over the next few years? Obviously, we're taking evidence on this at the moment and trying to, you know, address the issue. But what would you like to see happening in the next few years to ensure that we aren't having the same conversation in the lead up to 2027?
There's a number of different factors, and I think the most important thing is to look at this kind of methodically and look at the different actors and kind of break this down into specific actions and focused at specific actors, because within the system there are a number of kind of different gatekeepers, different structures that control who ends up having access to local councils and to elected office. And you know, we've got political parties who have a huge role in candidate selection, being one of the kind of major ways that they control as organisations who ends up having the opportunity to even get onto the ballot to be elected. There's obviously a huge role as well for kind of councils themselves and how they can improve their structures, processes, and create an environment that supports a more diverse range of people to make it into those spaces. Of course, there's kind of a role as well at kind of government parliamentary level. I think kind of going back down to looking at what parties can be doing specifically, selection has got to be kind of number one. And I think that there's a lot more research that definitely needs to happen to understand exactly exactly where the where the successes are, because there's a lot of different approaches to selection. that different political parties use to try and, or ostensibly with the goal of improving the number of women councillors that get elected. However, this is applied pretty inconsistently at the moment. There's no legal, Talat mentioned quotas there. Obviously, our preference would be for quotas to be able to be introduced at a national level and for parties to have to use these. However, at the moment, that isn't possible. So we would encourage political parties to enshrine voluntary quotas or to adopt mechanisms within their election bylaws, within the way that they select candidates, to ensure that, to hold themselves to account and to actually have that codified in their own operating documents, to hold themselves to account on the number of candidates and the number of women candidates and diverse candidates that they actually put forward for election. So I think that would have to be number one. There's differing progress in different parts of the country on this, but right now, that's the biggest one, because we see, pockets of progress happening where selection procedures may have been applied well, but then in other kind of election to election, this is not consistent, and then progress is able to kind of backslide. I think also parties need to be really vocal about their interest and support for the welfare of all councillors, but particularly women councillors, and kind of be really vocal about their support for improved parental leave, for example. Right now we know that councillors don't have guaranteed access to parental leave, which is going to be a huge deterrent for many people, particularly many women. The salary is obviously a huge issue as well. So I think just parties taking this seriously and thinking, actually, we need to be vocal about our support for the welfare of those people that we're putting forward into this position. There's certainly work as well that councils need to be doing around thinking about the issue of parental leave. I think that in the previous session, COSLA produced their voluntary guidance on parental leave policy, and we know that this has not been taken up consistently across council areas. So we would want to see all councils across Scotland have some provision in place for things like parental leave. Councils need to be taking action on working practices with gendered impacts, thinking about the hours of business, the duties that are contingent on the role, and making sure that council business is taking place at times of day, various times of day perhaps, or times of day that suit schedules of different people with different lives, different responsibilities, caring responsibilities, or perhaps family responsibilities, which disproportionately impact women, and ensuring that that's taken into account when kind of designing, when meetings are held, when business takes place. There's all kinds of things, and this is detailed, we go into some detail about this in the materials, I think, that were shared before this session as well. I think one thing that we are really pleased to see, I think, is that the barriers to elected office group at COSLA is going to continue. That has been a great focal point for a lot of women councillors that we've spoken to, have spoken highly of this group and of the value of having a focal point for issues that affect women councillors. So we're really pleased to see that is going to be continuing, hopefully, in the next session. I think the number one issue, just to finally say, has got to be remuneration and pay, and that really has to increase if we are, if we hope to see more women councillors being able to put themselves forward and more make that a more viable option for more people from across the community.
Thank you for that very thorough response, Jessie. And I just want to say that I really appreciate your work, the work of Elect Her and Women 50-50. And I got to participate in a really wonderful event last week with a couple of MSP colleagues around the kind of raising confidence and inspiring women to step forward, certainly to consider the Parliament. I'm going to move on rather than bringing in Hannah and Jessie, because we've got a range of questions that, in a way, you've kind of started to touch on. So I'm going to bring in Annie Wells with another question, and she is joining us online. And hopefully she's there.
Hi, good morning, panel, and thank you very much for coming along. I think I want to see more women in politics. I certainly have campaigned on it for the last 7 years, and I want to make sure that all parties are making the effort to bring more women into frontline politics. But I'd like to just go to Jessie, if I can. And gender research showed significant variation in the rates of women candidates across Scotland. And I know you sort of touched on this a little bit, but I was just wondering if you could give us what the reasons are for such variation. For example, 16% in the Western Isles, 22% in South Ayrshire, and 44% in East Lothian. So I didn't know if you could give us a wee bit of background into what the research showed on that.
Jessie?
Hello?
We can hear you.
Great. Can I just check, is that the rates of retention that you were looking at? Because I think that was...
Of candidates across Scotland.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, I think that it's a really interesting question, and something that definitely warrants further investigation. Because, like you mentioned, like there are areas where things are working well, there are pockets of success, and indeed some of that has translated in our initial kind of analysis as well into the final numbers of women councillors across the country as well. There are you know, one or two council areas that are really like forging ahead in terms of in terms of women's representation, and then there are others that are really lagging behind. And anecdotally, I think some of that has got is cultural, and some of that is a cyclical thing as well. I think areas that have historically had especially low representation of women, it's back to this issue of not having the impetus to change because of the low numbers of women. So it'd be interesting with further investigation to know if these are the areas that, for example, have been slower to uptake policies like the voluntary parental leave policy, and to adopt that, to kind of be proactive in showing that this is a workplace, this is a space that women are welcome, and that is taking into account their interests. I think that there's going to be a huge amount of this is down to party politics as well, and internal party politics across the country, which is something that we do need more information to be able to understand. I think that just a note quickly as well on the data, like obviously this is our kind of own initial analysis, and it's based on assumptions, and it's definitely imperfect, and it's not the ideal way to be collecting data. So, it's not necessarily 100% accurate, but it's kind of as best as we've got at the moment. I think it would be, there'll be dynamics, and it'd be interesting to see if, to do more analysis at a kind of party level to understand where, if a particular party is doing particularly well on women's representation, does that map onto the geographic spread as well? Is that something that we need to dig into further? I think what we do know is that there are commonalities across the country, though, and a lot of the issues, just because one area is doing well, there's nowhere that is absolutely getting this right. And a lot of the measures that we've recommended will see improvements being made in many council areas. But yeah, I think more digging in with specific parties would be interesting.
Thanks for that, convener. Thank you, Jessie.
Thanks very much for that response. And it's good. It's good to hear the work that you're doing to, even try to gather what data we can get, and hopefully down the line we'll be able to get better data. So I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair with a couple of questions.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. As a former councillor, I understand many reasons why women stand down. Sometimes the average length of the council meeting could be 7 hours. And I remember when I first stood as a councillor back in 2003, that council meetings were still going on to 1 o'clock in the morning. So it's hardly a family-friendly environment. And I think that's one of the reasons why women are standing down. What other evidence have we found that only after one or two terms that, you know, women are deciding to stand down? Can you explain this? And I'll pop that to Hannah, if that's okay.
Sure. There hasn't been research. We saw in May this year, anecdotally between our organisations, you know, we work closely alongside each other, and we started to see that women in our community who were already elected were saying informally, anecdotally, I'm not going to stand again, I'm not going to stand again. And as a response to that, a researcher working within gender did interview 8 email councillors who were standing down. But that is the only documentation that we have of the narrative around that. And there's real challenges that they're facing. A massive amount of it is the remuneration. We're going to keep saying that. People are not paid enough money to do this incredible job. And I hope that in the second panel, you'll be able to explore that further. A toxic culture within local government is something that came up time and time again as well. Still a very masculine, archaic, patriarchal, misogynistic culture across the council, even within party groups as well. And it's just an unpleasant space to be in. And it doesn't have to be like that. But for the women that we've spoken to anecdotally and that participated in the qualitative research, these were some of the key issues that were coming forward about why they didn't want to put themselves through it for another term. And it's such a shame because we're putting this energy into really encouraging women on this pipeline, and then they're burnt and so don't want to continue. And actually, there's such a lot to learn when you become a councillor that many of them say they'd only just really got their feet under the table in terms of how to do the job well and how they wanted to do the job. And that was the time to step down. And so therefore we have to do all the work to encourage another generation. But really what we need to be doing is both ends of the site. We need to be creating the conditions where women can thrive, and whilst also creating a pipeline. But at the moment we're creating a pipeline of women, encouraging them into it. They're giving it one term and then stepping down because of culture and finances primarily. And as you mentioned, the incompatibility with caring responsibilities. And there's so much more that can be done to improve the conditions once they're in there. And there's a lot of recommendations in the written materials that we submitted in advance of this session.
Thank you, Hannah. That's one of the reasons why I chose to stay and change the culture within, you know, councils. I'll pop that on to Talu as well, if you'd like to maybe expand further.
Certainly, yes, I can do. I'm hoping you can still hear me. But there's, in terms of Women 50/50's existence, again, it's anecdotal. At the head of now 2 council elections that we've existed, our campaign has existed in, we have messages, emails, first-hand experiences that are written up and sent to us, and it's a combination of a lack of compatibility when they have caring responsibilities, and whilst we have a disproportionate level of care expected by women and we don't have that equality within home, then it does become incompatible to be at council meetings from 6 p.m. until 10 p.m, which is still very normal within the council setting. The second is, of course, maternity and paternity leave. Now, what's interesting is that COSLA has created guidance. We have particularly women councillors who are taking on the work of advocating for better cultures. Yet it's not a standard, it's not a requirement. And really, we should be looking at our politics, particularly our local democracy, as leading by example on these areas when it comes to fairness and access. So it's still quite extraordinary to me that maternity and paternity leave isn't standard and isn't of a high quality. And the third is, as Hannah has mentioned, really toxic cultures. Even if you make your way through politics, through an election, and then get to be a councillor, what we're seeing is a revolving door, a disproportionate number of women who only stand for one term and then leave because they've been put off. And this will only serve to create a negative image of it and prevent women from wanting to come through and be councillors themselves. What I have seen too often, and having conversations across councils when we're presenting about what Women 50/50 believes needs to happen, is a real denial of the existence of the issue. We are still working and focusing on this deficit model of the skills that women don't have, what women don't know. And our focus is on what women need to learn or change rather than what the culture and the system needs to change. So whilst I absolutely agree that the work of Elect Her does a lot of work on that pipeline, that's only one half of it. And for that to be successful, you also need the self-reflection and action of cultures and systems within councils, and to stop the kind of abdicating of responsibility onto the deficit of potential candidates or diverse communities participating in or not having the skills or confidence. That's part of the issue, but what creates a lack of confidence is the culture. So we need more activity in accepting the reality of inequalities and toxic cultures, sexism and discrimination, racism that might be happening within councils. And we have the anecdotal evidence and wider of that. And we need a reality check of what councils can do and how the system needs to change, not simply the women or the marginalised communities.
Thank you. I'll just move on to my next question. I know again from experience how the role of a councillor has changed. Certainly, I can say that for the last 19 years, and know how councillors deserve a pay rise. There's been many changes. Can you expand on these for the committee's benefit, on how the role's changed, and given the pressures on Scottish Government and local government funding, how should pay rises be funded? I'll pop that to Hannah again, if that's OK.
I would say, honestly, I don't think I'm the best person to respond to this. I think that COSRA have done a huge amount of exploration and research around the remuneration. So I'd rather step back from that question and let them as the experts respond to that.
Sure. Talu, I hope that's your name, sorry, Talat, sorry. Do you want to maybe, if you can answer that, if not, we can wait to the next session.
Yes, it's Talat Yakub, thank you. I think COSLA is best placed, but in the question of how it's changed, we've also got to realise that there is more that has been devolved down to local governments. There's more work that is done. Whilst there are further powers given to Scotland, that also means more that is happening in local government. There's also the reality that politics and participating as an elected official, particularly with social media, means that it's not a part-time role. The expectation is to be available all of the time. So then remuneration needs to also reflect that. Where the funding comes from, COSLA can explain well. I think our local government needs to be funded to be able to enable that. But we can't expect candidates to put themselves forward whilst actually being in financial deficit, losing money to be able to do such critical jobs and make decisions on behalf of their communities, on behalf of their constituencies. So the role has changed. The role has become more demanding. There is more that's expected of local councils, and the availability and visibility is expected much more than it was 10, 15 years ago or beyond. So looking at that, there also needs to be a better reflection when it comes to remuneration to understand just how involved and just how high the expectation is of participation and availability of councillors.
Thank you. Convener, that's my question, Sydney. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Marie. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin with some questions.
Thanks, Convener. I agree with the points made so far about how important remuneration is to improve diversity. I already agree fully with that point, but I just wonder if there's any evidence out there that we would be able to use to support that. And I'm thinking particularly international evidence. Is there any international evidence out there on remuneration levels of for councillors, which is set at a higher level than it is here in Scotland, has led to increased diversity of candidates and councillors themselves? I don't know, perhaps come to Hannah Stevens first.
Not that I'm aware of. Again, COSLA might be able to talk to you about that in light of their own research and the international context of that, but I'm not aware of that. But what I am aware of is that hundreds and hundreds of conversations that we have with women, they come to us to learn what does it mean. I'm vaguely interested in standing for local government. What does that mean? As we run workshops, webinars, conversations to talk about it, we demystify the process, and we need to do more to encourage women to stand and better information about the work and the impact of being a councillor. But so many of them, then we tell them the stories, they listen to councillors in similar sessions that was mentioned earlier, and they're shocked to learn that it isn't a structured job with an agreed time commitment and appropriate remuneration. That is a surprise to people who are outside of the system and interested in peering inside. And when they hear about the amounts or that they would be remunerated and hear about the expectations of the role, we are honest, we speak authentically, we want to encourage women to do it. We are optimistic, but we are honest about the challenges they face. Lots and lots of women go, oh, that was interesting, but not for me. I couldn't possibly do that alongside my day job. So I don't know about the international context. I don't know about a wider base of research. But what I do know is I hear a lot of women go, oh, that's a shame. Not for me, though. Thanks very much. And then they carry on with their lives and they contribute to their communities in other ways. And we're missing out on some fantastic talent because the structure, it just isn't possible to run a family or pay a mortgage on that amount of money, and the hours required are too much, really, in order to balance that alongside alternative forms of employment.
Thanks, and Talat wants to come in on this as well.
Yes, thank you. There isn't a Scotland-specific data that's been carried out on this, but I do know that there's been a review of council remuneration and local government participation, a review that was done in Wales. And I'm quite sure that that includes international examples from, I think, Germany, New Zealand, and also Republic of Ireland, where councillors are paid the same and are aligned to senior public servants, those in the public service. And I understand that in New Zealand, it is based on council remuneration is based on the size of the council, the population size, and how much is expected of that council. And I'm not saying that there's either of those are necessarily the right way forward. It's dependent on the funding that's available. But I'm happy to share with the clerk of the committee the research that was conducted by the Welsh Government.
That'd be really welcome. Thanks, Talat. If I can move on to another point, and I wanted to talk about legal disqualification for standing for council. Now, just now, there is a legal disqualification for standing as a candidate for a council if you happen to be employed by that local authority. Now, given that we know that the proportion of employees in local authorities is predominantly female, is that a bigger barrier to have female candidates for council, particularly when they would have such good knowledge of the inner workings of that organisation and bring so much to an elected role? Come to Jessie first, if that's okay.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an excellent point, and I agree. I think that think about the size of an employer that a local council is, just numerically, that is a huge number of people, a huge number of women. Women do tend to be disproportionately employed in the social care sector, in education, obviously huge huge areas for huge local government employers, who would have excellent inside knowledge, who would have excellent experience and a lot to contribute probably to many discussions around service delivery. I agree. I think that would definitely something to look at, something to review and hopefully, well, possibly change.
Hannah, you would like to come in on this as well?
So earlier on this year, the three different island community local authorities approached us about running some workshops for women within their communities in advance of the May elections this year. So at the end of 2021 and early 2022, we ran three online workshops, and the Western Isles itself pre-May had not a single female councillor on it. It was the only authority, I believe, in the UK, in Britain, that was the case. And so we delivered a workshop with them, and that was a huge issue that particularly in the Western Isles, as an example, that a large number of people employed on the island are therefore are employed by in local services. And so therefore were in unable to stand for elected office. And so in those communities where there is a large employer, the council itself is a large employer, it's a huge barrier, particularly. And then again, we get back to the case where people would need to resign their jobs and the security of their salary in order to take the risk of being elected to then receive a lower remuneration. So for a lot of people in those particular conversations in that one geographical area, that was a fundamental barrier that came out very, very loudly.
Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Mark. And thanks, Hannah. That's very interesting. I think I participated in that session as well, which was very useful, but it is concerning that people can't then come forward. Now I'd like to move on with questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convena. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us this morning. I wanted to talk about more in more detail with regards to culture within councils, and specifically to look to the last 5-6 months when we've had new councillors in place. And I just wondered if you had any learning you could tell the committee with regards to any training which has been provided, and where councils make their newly elected members actually feel welcome and part of that organisation. Obviously, we have councils in Scotland of very different size of elected members. So I just wondered if there's any evidence you have of that sort of introductory phase for new councillors as well.
Anybody in particular you want to?
I can start with Hannah then.
Hannah.
We've only had a few small conversations, but just last month we ran an online gathering for women who had been exactly this, who were elected in May and who were new to the jobs. They'd been in role 4 months. It's really hit and miss. I think there's no consistency around, again, all of my information is anecdotally based on conversations. So again, I think COSLA would be better placed to give you a more structured answer. But anecdotally, women were saying it was very hit and miss around the support and the welcoming that they'd had in council. There's such a huge amount of information to take on board. And often those women who were given training and were welcomed and supported by individuals within the older cohort of councillors felt eased and transitioned into the role very well. Whereas there were many others that just found themselves standing there, not knowing what questions to ask, but being in a position where they have to ask the questions. So again, finding it quite an overwhelming experience. And already 4 months in, I'll be honest, a real feeling of tiredness and exhaustion already, that it had been a very difficult journey in terms of getting your feet under the table, as it were, and understanding what the role is and how to navigate the responsibilities and the work in the community. So I think there's a real opportunity for peer support, which is why we gathered that. But there's a real opportunity to bring women together to share those experiences. But again, I think that would be something that could be really helpful in creating that space for women to thrive, having people to turn to that is a safe space where you can ask questions. But really, the training needs to be much more structured in place, that there is an orientation process that is put there to make them feel secure and welcomed and like they have the ability to achieve in the role.
Thank you for that. Does anyone else want to come in? Jessie?
I think that training is obviously a huge thing. I think it's, like Hannah was giving some insight there about training needs of women councillors that are coming in. And that's certainly a really big part of it. I think all councillors need a lot more training on issues of sexism, discrimination, how to conduct yourself within the chamber, and how to kind of avoid perpetuating some of the toxic culture and style of debate and general kind of overall toxic atmosphere that many women have talked about experiencing within the chamber. So I think that training, like we need to talk about training for all councillors when we talk about training. I think another thing, just obviously councillors receive such a huge amount of information when they start, like Hannah was saying. One thing that has been mentioned in a couple of conversations that I've had is around the councillor code of conduct, and that this really, while it exists, is not really adequate in addressing some of the specific kind of situations and situations that enable a very combative and aggressive environment to thrive within the chamber, which itself is often quoted by women councillors that we speak to as motivating factors in their decision to stand down or not run or stand for fewer terms. So interestingly, and this is anecdotal as well, some of the councillors that we've spoken to are kind of are aware of this and think that there needs to be more of a code of conduct that is very, very specific to council business. I think the current code of conduct kind of mentions it is very, very broad brush and talks about the need for respect between to behave with respect. Talks about standards, but very, very little specific information around how to conduct yourself in a debate, for example, language that shouldn't be permitted. I think that something that is more specific in the way that councillors relate to each other and that tries to actually address and kind of dismantle some of the attitudes and some of the cultural issues that we've talked about would be something that should be looked at. And again, that shouldn't be done on a kind of patchy basis. That should be something that should be applied across the country. All councils should be looking to adopt something that supports and enables all of their councillors to better do their jobs.
Thank you for that. And I think there's maybe learning from the Scottish Parliament. Well, the presiding officer might not agree with me in terms of the chamber, but there's probably learning from our code of conduct, which maybe also needs to be applied to those in elected office as well. There was a concerning story, which after the last election was in the Edinburgh Evening News with regards to a newly elected disabled member of Edinburgh City Council. And no assessment for her needs being taken into account whatsoever. Now, I hope that elected members coming to this Parliament feel that assessment does take place of any additional needs which we might have. But I just wondered if that's also something you've had feedback from newly elected members on as well.
Anybody, Talat, would like to come in on that?
Yes, thank you. So this is why the issue of intersecting inequalities becomes really important. When we are pursuing councils that work for women, and if we don't think about the intersecting inequalities of, for example, mobility issues, disability, race, English as a second language, all of those issues, what is likely to happen is that we create access to politics for those who are likely had some form of access, some form of political power and engagement. It's not those who are furthest away from access to opportunity, power and wealth, which is why it's so critical to think about this as a whole. So we need to think about the experiences of sexism, but also we need to think about how that intersects with marginalisation as a consequence of disability, mobility issues, a consequence of racism. One of the things that I've been told numerous times is the experience of intersecting experiences of racism and sexism and ableism and sexism happening within councils. I think it needs to be taken really seriously, because if we don't think about multiple marginalisations, like I said, we're likely to benefit the lowest hanging fruit rather than those who are furthest away from access to political participation. Many of our councils are operating in inaccessible ways, both inaccessible when we're talking about neurodiversity, inaccessible when it comes to modernisation and use of technology, and inaccessible in terms of the physical location, old buildings that have not been made accessible, physically accessible. All of this needs to be thought about if we're going to create, tackle the democratic deficit we have, and we're going to create councils which are reflective of the communities that they are meant to represent.
Thanks for that response, Talat. And before you go on, Miles, I'm just going to bring Paul in on a supplementary on that.
Yeah, thanks, Camino. I was just going to ask this question later on. It was really just an extension just to the question there. I mean, there's the Access to Elected Office Fund, and obviously that's meant to have an impact on a number of councillors with disabilities. I'm wondering just what more can be done to ensure more people with disabilities feel that they can put themselves forward for election. I don't know if anybody wants to come in on that one. Just really in the back of what Miles was saying there on a much broader aspect, I think we've heard that issue before in the committee. So I don't know if anybody wants to pick up on that one. Or add anything to it at all.
Is there anyone? Talat, maybe what do you know about the access to elected office fund and whether that's having an impact?
Yes, all I want to say was Inclusion Scotland and Glasgow Disability Alliance have both done work about particularly local government participation, Inclusion Scotland being the strategic partner when it comes to the Access to Politics Fund. And I think engaging with them as the kind of national experts on this would be particularly beneficial. What we have at Women 50-50 is women talking to us about the intersection of disability discrimination and sexism, and the experience of marginalisation and essentially being left to figure this out on your own. We were talking about training and kind of a induction and inclusiveness at the beginning of having that council participation. Again, that needs to be about beyond looking at people in silos, if they're women, if they're disabled. It's about all of those things and particularly how other people respond to access needs and ensure it's not an afterthought, but part of the infrastructure, the expectation of how council activities will take part. In fact, I believe that there should not be allowed to be council activities that are about public participation and wider participation that is done in an inaccessible way.
Thanks very much for that. And Jessie, I think you want to come in on this as well.
Talat's covered it.
Oh, OK. Super. Thanks. Miles, do you have any more?
Yeah, just finally, Convener. My final question was with regards to the fact that the vast majority of councillors in Scotland represent a political party and come through that political party network. So I just wondered, in your view, what more you think can be done. My own party, for example, established Women to Win. I think that's provided that peer support network, which was missing. So I just wondered, is there learning from other political parties which could help as well to try to turn the situation around? Hannah, will I bring you in first?
I think really the political parties have a huge role to play here, and it's almost unfortunate in some sense that they do, because there's so much opportunity when the political parties aren't involved, as you see in some of the island communities where it's predominantly independent standing. Then it becomes about community engagement and encouraging people who are active in the community to step forward and consider these roles. But the political parties, as you say, are involved in a majority of local authorities, so therefore that it's an additional level of gatekeeping. So even in response to your question a moment ago regarding disabled people's access, actually the journey to standing as a councillor is coming through the political party. So you have to, first of all, before you can even consider it, you have to be welcomed by the political party. Let's talk about disabled people in that sense, that therefore their party meetings have to be in accessible venues. And so we saw during the pandemic the rise in online meetings. There was a huge increase in disabled people's participation in political activity. It was a really, really positive thing. But unfortunately, there has been quite a rush to return to in-person meetings, which again, it means that disabled people find it harder to participate. So I think the political parties have so much to do. There's lots of parties have different mechanisms to selecting candidates. Not all of them do, but some. But I think we need to go earlier into the process. Is the party meeting a welcoming place to people with intersecting identities? Are people of colour, are women of colour feeling welcome to go to that party meeting on a Tuesday evening to get involved in the party? For so many of the parties, you have to have membership for 12 months before you can consider before you can be considered to be a candidate. So there's a really long run up and you have to have real access to information. So again, I think the political parties don't provide transparent information about the selection mechanisms. So again, it's another space where it feels like it's this slightly toxic culture. It's this behind closed doors, and you have to get in with the right people to find the right information so that you can understand what the journey ahead is. So I think there's so much to be said and so much to be done for parties. And I will say, from our perspective, different parties are trying different mechanisms, but none of them have got it right.
Thanks for that. And I believe Talat and then Jessie would like to come in on this as well.
Yes, thank you. So there's a few things within this, and I'll come back to my point about the deficit model. So I do believe that there is a place for training for potential women candidates, for marginalised communities, and the network, as Miles Briggs MSP pointed out there, that the Conservative Party participate in. Most parties had some kind of network, but it can't be the only mechanism that exists, because our evidence shows us again and again that when the focus is on women skilling up and not the culture and the system transforming, changing and tackling its inherent inequalities that are in the fabric of the system, then all that happens is women take on the work of tackling the sexism and discrimination that they face themselves. So we, whilst there is a place for that, we cannot, I think it would be really wrong for us to focus on women and on skilling up only, and not looking at the system. Now, political parties use all-women shortlists. Obviously, Women 50-50 advocates for candidate quotas, because what we see is when there are quotas, there is infrastructure and system change within political parties. There becomes an impetus to do something about the lack of candidates from diverse backgrounds, marginalised backgrounds, and women particularly coming forward. There is the creation of some form of accountability and some infrastructure and system change. And I think it's important that I say that whilst there is lots of myths about quotas, quotas promote those with merit. And whenever we have seen quotas be implemented, we see the average level of merit actually increase. We see the promotion of merit to be more likely, because we do not exist in our political space within a meritocracy. So I think that there's a range of things that need to happen by political parties. But it can't. One part of that is the network, the training for women, but it's the culture change, accountability, reporting mechanisms, and in our view, quota mechanisms that need to be taken forward for it to be systemic change.
Thanks very much. And Jessie, you want to come in too?
Yeah, just quickly, I completely agree with what has been said by both Hannah and Talat so far. Just on the note of looking at what parties do to change their structures and change their culture from within, and not putting that impetus on women or on those that are experiencing the discrimination or underrepresentation. We, along with Elector, with 50-50, with Inclusion Scotland, SEMVO, BMS, Stonewall Scotland, and organisations from across the equality sector have produced the Equal Representation in Politics Toolkit. As a solution, this is an online tool, and it's an off-the-shelf kind of set of self-assessment resources that cover a spectrum of party life, things around selection processes, how to hold inclusive meetings, around kind of cultural issues, handling complaints, bullying, harassment, kind of all different types of issues that might come up typically in party life. And it's available online. It's a very quick quick self-assessment tool. And we encourage, we are encouraging, and we offer training on this toolkit and how to get the most out of it. I think that, as with all of this, like, it needs to be used consistently. We know that it is working well where it is being used at the moment, but it's encouraging kind of people within the grassroots at parties who really control who decides to come along to a meeting and then who decides to come back, crucially, because it's getting involved, but it's also staying involved that is often the challenge. It's right from the ground up going, like, how do we change? How do we accommodate and show that we are serious about improving representation of women and of others who are underrepresented? I think also parties, you know, have a duty of care to their members, and that is, again, varies hugely party to party, local party to local party. But I think that councillors and council candidates, and this is something that we've heard from those that we've spoken to, often feel themselves falling through the gaps of various different kind of support or welfare processes. And, you know, they're technically not the employees of their party, but there is a duty of care there, or there should be, to enable to support them and to improve the conditions that they have to work within their parties, as with any kind of workplace. So I think that parties, yeah, really, really need to take this issue seriously, and there's an off-the-shelf solution that can help with this, but we'd encourage them to adopt it and to kind of formally require through whatever party mechanisms their members or local branches, etc., to use it and to make the most out of it as a starting point. But it does need to happen in tandem with all these other kind of mechanisms as well. Because as with anything, one of these methods will only get us so far.
Thanks, Jesse, for your response, and thanks, Maz, for the questions. I'm now going to move to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone on the panel. I just wanted to stick with the theme of support for our elected members, councillors who are currently in office, and just maybe to ask each of you for one or two suggestions about how we can improve this. I think you've all mentioned training and the opportunities for training for new councillors, and particularly beneficial when you're in the post. But what else can you see by way of support that might be needed? And I'm thinking back to our experience during COVID, when one of the few good things that came out of COVID was the whole digital hybrid model becoming available to elected members. And I saw the benefit of that in here in the Scottish Parliament, but also know it was a huge benefit to elected councillors right across Scotland in giving them a greater ability to participate in the business of the council, which respected family issues as well, which was a great boost to many councillors. So I wonder if I could invite each of you just to offer us a suggestion or two about what the support, better support mechanisms might be going forward. And I might as well start with Tala, if that's okay.
Yes, of course. You saw the modernisation during COVID. Like you said, it was one of the few good things to come out of that period. A lot of women talked to us about the fact that made it more accessible. So I absolutely believe modernisation, access to technology to prevent the kind of presenteeism in council chambers and to make it more accessible would be one. The second is the expectation of councillors to be participating in meetings late into the evening, the expectation of the level of work, whilst it continues to be seen as part-time, needs to be reviewed. Remuneration needs to be reviewed to be in line with the level of work that's required. And the final thing that I would say is that there needs to be more robust, more transparent reporting mechanisms that everybody is made aware of, that creates a sense of safety and security for women and marginalised communities when they participate, to be able to report issues related to sexism, discrimination, any kind of bigotry and inequality, where it is transparent, open, robustly investigated, and then action taken forward. When we have those kinds of reporting mechanisms and that transparency within local government, it gives people a feeling of safety and trust, and it also prevents these issues from occurring because people see that there would be consequences to this kind of behaviour. So modernisation and technology, absolutely. A review of timings and the expectation of the level of work, if it is to remain part-time. Linked to that is remuneration, and finally, better reporting, transparency and accountability models.
Thank you, Tala. Hannah?
I think Talat's really put it very well there. There's one additional piece. I think that often in local authorities, there is a department called member support, but we've heard time and time again how it's just not enough support. And the difference between MSPs and MPs when elected, with that comes a budget to enable you to hire staff, support you in casework and in your parliamentary preparation, and just the dearth of that type of support, administrative support, that members support within local authorities aren't able to support members in the way that they would truly like to. So a little bit more administrative support in really allowing them to achieve their roles is another factor that I think could be considered.
Thanks, Hannah. Jesse?
Been said, I think everything does go back to remuneration and the need to recognise that that's the biggest form of support is, councillors being able to know that they're being fairly compensated for their work. And the remote working, again, that's something that I'm speaking to councillors, like, this is something, again, that is a patchy application nationwide. You know, councillors in some areas are saying that there's like a real push to return to kind of try and phase out remote working, which is obviously hugely concerning, because I think that we know that the experience of COVID has shown us that having a hybrid model is the ideal way to ensure that people have different options to participate, and that's crucial. It's crucial that it's retained and it's understood to be best practice, and that goes particularly for rural areas as well, where commuting distances are huge, and as many not exclusively, but we know that there are some rural areas that do have particularly low levels of women's representation from the initial numbers that we've looked at. So, you know, whatever can be done to help women be able to participate in these areas in particular needs to be taken really seriously. I think absolutely there needs to be something around an impartial complaints procedure as well. I think that there was a report, and it's referenced in the resources that we published in one of the reports, that in England and Wales, Fawcett Society did, that was one of their major recommendations on a huge piece of work that they did as one of the main mechanisms that they recommend to improving women's representation long term is improving how complaints and instances of discrimination are handled sensitively and completely impartially. I think that the issues around improving the code of conduct, or perhaps looking to a new kind of code of conduct or terms of reference for debate and activity that actually happens within the chamber, is something that needs to be looked at. There was as well an example that I don't know if other councils might want to look at it, but three women councillors who were stepping down at the end of last session put together a model policy. This was in Glasgow and published it and put it forward as a motion within councils outlining what they felt needs to happen in order to kind of address the issues that had motivated them not to run again. And there's kind of lots of complaints is a big part of that. There's also kind of other things around debate within the chamber, within hours of work. And, you know, that's something that maybe individual councils can look at in the short term, but in an ideal world, we would obviously want something that can be applied consistently so that there isn't so much variation in the experiences of women across the country.
Okay.
I think that's everything.
That's great, Jessie. Thank you to three of you for those contributions. Very important, I think, to make those points. My only other question is really about numbers, is to ask if we have data available that shows us the number of female councillors from ethnic backgrounds in Scotland and Scotland's councils. Would any of you have that information and data, and would you be able to share it with the committee, please, if you have it?
So the data that we have, I don't have that data, unfortunately. So we're awaiting the publication of the results of the candidate diversity survey that was run for the first time, that I understand are to be published soon. And maybe that will help improve the picture that we kind of already have. One of the greatest challenges at the moment is that all the data that we have on the number of women councillors is gathered by organisations like ourselves, and we do not have the information available publicly to offer us to be able to carry out an intersectional analysis. So we don't have any data, certainly not any data that would be accurate on that. I don't know if any of the other panellists have anything.
Talat would like to come in as well. Talat? I think your audio has gone. I think maybe we'll have to move on for now, and hopefully we were doing so well. Oh, here we've got, now we've got your picture. That's nice to see you.
I'm not sure if you can hear me.
Oh, now. Yes, great. Go on.
Okay. Apologies, not sure what's happening. In terms of numbers, Women 50/50 does its own kind of check through of who is elected. We're a voluntary organisation, we're run on volunteers, and we do this as much as we can. And you can imagine there's over 1,200 councillors that are elected, and we're trying to get the numbers we have. The issue is that we do not have the data where people identify themselves, where they identify their own ethnicity, their nationality, their sexuality, where they provide this data. So if we are to do that accurately, sensitively and robustly, actually it is up to councils to publish that data, to invest in finding that data, or for COSLA and others to get that data and publish it. So we don't have the intersecting data to tell us about ethnic minorities. What we do have is, anecdotally, we know that there is not a fair representation of ethnic minorities in our councils. And we know that there has never been a population, relative population sample over the years of ethnic minorities. So we would expect to see, you know, between kind of 6% and 10% of councillors from ethnic minorities. We haven't seen that. What we do know is that 35% of councillors that were elected in 2022 were women, that it's an increase of 6% from 2017, but 85 multi-member wards remain as all male councillors, compared to only 12 multi-member wards where it's all women. So we can see that data we have, data that is about ethnicity, sexuality, we don't think it's appropriate for us to determine that and look at pictures or names online to be able to tell us that information. That should be coming from the councils directly.
Thanks very much for that, Talam. Something I think the committee will probably want to pursue. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Willie. Paul, I think you've got a question on data. Do you want to come in on a supplement?
Yeah, I think it's kind of been touched on. I don't know if anybody else wants to add anything there. Because I think historically, I mean, previous surveys of candidates and councillors have had low return rates. And I think you've kind of all touched on about your own interaction with candidates and councillors. Is there anything else do you think more could be done to ensure a higher rate and more representative rate of return on these kind of surveys? And Jessie, probably kick off for yourself if anybody else wants to come in.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, yeah, it'll be interesting to see what the return rate is. Like you say, historically, it's been fairly low. Our preference would be for a mandatory system for gathering this data. That's obviously done sensitively and with plenty of, you know, designed in a way that is not demanding this data of anyone, but that a survey itself is a mandatory part of nomination forms. I think that it's certainly time to kind of get creative in thinking about how responses could be maximised. I think a longer term comms strategy to encourage parties to encourage their candidates, because again, anecdotally, when this survey was being rolled out earlier this year, I think that in some areas it'll be really, really interesting to see if there's a geographical breakdown, if there's a party breakdown, to see where that messaging was getting out to candidates on the ground, and where they were seeing the value of providing this information and completing the survey. So I think it's how it's pitched that's been able to demonstrate that providing this data enables everything to work a lot better, to be able to, you know, understand where the gaps are in terms of representation, understand where work needs to be undertaken at all levels to improve that next time round, and be able to show that value to people. I think something that I think continuing to work with parties is obviously really, really important. I wonder if there's an option to work with them around their internal mechanisms around candidate agreements, or, you know, documentation like this, that when people are standing for election, that they are made aware and make some kind of agreement perhaps to complete the survey. This is maybe something that needs a bit more look at, but that's kind of why with all the work that we've done in looking at this area and in this campaign, this is a 5-year challenge now, or kind of coming on to a 4-year challenge. If the survey is to be run again and we want a higher response rate next time, like, the work kind of needs to happen now to lay that groundwork to make people aware of it, to make parties aware of it. That does leave a challenge for independent candidates and how to be capturing that data, because you can't go through the parties and use those structures. So I wonder if there's anything, you know, that can be done working directly with councils in areas that have high proportions of independent candidates to help get that message out on the ground. But luckily, I think the key thing is that these conversations begin now and are continued for the next 4 years and aren't coming last minute, to allow maximum time to get everyone aware of it and prepared for it.
Thanks, Jessie. If anybody else wants to come in.
Nope, doesn't look like it.
Thanks for that.
Okay, great. That was good. So thank you so much for all joining us this morning to give us very thorough responses. And I think it's helpful. I've got pages of notes here on things that we can follow up on. So I'm now going to suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. We're now joined virtually by our second panel of witnesses to continue our evidence taking on understanding barriers to local elected office. And I welcome to the meeting Councillor Shona Morrison, who is the President of COSLA. And I want to especially welcome you because I think this is the first time you've joined the committee in your new role. So a big warm welcome to you today. And Councillor Morrison is joined today by Alexis Campbell, who's the Policy and Participation Officer of the Qualities at COSLA as well. Before I open up the session to questions from members, I'd like to invite Councillor Morrison, I'd like to invite you to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everybody. And yes, quite rightly, my first time giving evidence. So another part of this diverse and wide-ranging role of a councillor. I'd like to thank Convener and committee members for the invitation to give evidence this morning and contribute to the committee's ongoing work in barriers to local elected office. This is an area of work that has been a key priority for COSLA for a number of years. And I'd like to acknowledge the work, the hard work of my predecessor, Councillor Alison Evison, in driving this forward in her role as the previous COSLA president. It is clear that there is still much to be done to remove barriers to sections of our community that are currently underrepresented in Scottish local elected office. We cannot consider local democracy to be representative until our councillors truly reflect the diversity of the communities that they serve. The voices of lived experience from across our communities are needed at the decision-making tables at all levels of the political systems, and local government is no exception. I particularly welcome the opportunity to speak about financial barriers to elected office. As a result, the current rate of council remuneration, as many potential candidates are priced out by the low rate of pay that a local elected member currently receives. For individuals who do decide to stand and are ultimately elected, the financial pressures that result from the rate of remuneration lead to many councillors having to balance their responsibilities as an elected member with a second paid job and, in many cases, caring responsibilities. This has a significant impact on female members in particular, and we heard of many examples of women councillors deciding not to seek re-election this year simply because they could not afford to remain a councillor. Things must change to ensure that financial and indeed all other barriers to elected office are removed. And I welcome the committee's continued focus on this issue. I'm very happy to be here this morning to answer questions. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much for that. And you've kind of already touched a little bit on some of what we're going to cover, but it's good that we have this opportunity to get into a bit more detail. And I'd like to begin by focusing on the slow progress towards increased gender representation among councillors. And given the steps taken by various organisations over the past 10 years, I wonder if you have a sense, you pointed to remuneration as one, for example, but other things that might be the barriers that contribute to this slow pace of improvement in the number of female councillors in Scotland.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, thank you. And I really appreciated listening in to the last representatives who were here from gender and women 50-50 and their contributions. And I think possibly, you know, we would cover the same issues with regards to barriers for women. So absolutely remuneration being right up at the top of you know, certain surveys that we have responded from local authorities as being a major barrier to elected office. I think women also experience in particular real struggle trying to balance the working day as a councillor. In my previous role in my own authority as a senior councillor, you know, my day was began in the early hours of the morning and often finished very late at night. Having to balance several roles, several chairs and other responsibilities within the council's strategic boards, as well as the time spent within our communities, which is obviously where we need to be seen and to be listening so that we are, you know, accurately representing those who have elected us into office. So I do think that pressure of workload is significant. Certainly having spoke anecdotally to colleagues who chose not to stand again in the election earlier this year, that was part of the contributing factor was that balancing, especially for women councillors, of child caring responsibilities. Many councils, as you'll still be aware, and I'm aware that we have a lot of experience at the table who've been in the position of being local councillors in the past, will know that many councils still meet in the evenings. And although that may work for many people, it certainly doesn't for others. So I think ours absolutely is a factor which deters women and other marginalised groups from standing for office. I would also suggest that there is significant culture issues within councils, and I think colleagues have absolutely need correct representations in the last hour about what some of those difficulties are. Again, around those kind of systems in place to support specifically, I think, women in those roles who perhaps are faced with very difficult, fairly toxic working environments. And again, anecdotally, my experience from colleagues has been that it's been another significant contributing factor to decisions not to stand again for a re-election.
Thanks very much for that response. You'll have heard, it's great that you were able to listen in on our previous evidence session, and you will have heard me asking for thoughts about the representation of young women in local authorities. And I just wonder if you have anything more to say about that in terms of the challenges that they may face even further in being elected.
Yeah, I suppose that's an area that within my own authority we've absolutely identified as being an issue, just that ability to encourage younger people to engage in local politics. And, we've certainly advocated presence in our council of, representatives from local high schools, and many of our primary schools do encourage elected members to go in to speak to the children about local democracy and why local democracy matters. And, that's something I've participated in myself and really welcomed. I think the earlier we can get that message across to our young people about the importance of certainly young women standing for office, the better. So that's great. But I think that probably just going back to what I've highlighted already, that it's difficult for those anecdotal stories not to become part of elected members' stories about their experience, and obviously that influences decisions that our young people make about standing for office. Now, again, I would reflect back on that toxicity within many of our councils that women specifically face in their day-to-day work.
Thanks very much for that. That's actually, I've just been inspired about, yes, needing to interact more with high schools, and maybe there's something we can do about that. Looking to the future, and again, it's the same question that I asked in the previous session. What are COSLA doing to ensure that we aren't having this same conversation in 2027?
I was reflecting back just in the break there about the last comments. I'm not sure it was Jason that made them about, this needs to be ongoing. We can't wait until we're at the precipice of another election before we become really reactive. So I'm delighted that it's been a very busy first few months in this role, but I was absolutely delighted to confirm that our special interest group barriers to elected office has been reconvened. Hopefully we'll have a paper going to our council leaders next month, to get their agreement to reconvene. And I think that'll bring a different conversation. We're now in a bit of a different landscape and a lot of new members, so interested to see what that group is going to look like and what the priorities are going to be, considering we are in a very, very different landscape and facing massive challenges within local authority. And of course that narrative is something we're living and breathing every day. So I think potentially we will have a bigger challenge in the next round of local elections for councils to attract candidates, because it's an incredibly challenging role to fulfil, and I think with the pressures on people's own finances, those factors which I've covered, the remuneration, the pressure of hours, workload, etc., will be very difficult for most people to make that decision about, you know, is this something they're willing to commit to as they face all the pressure, these pressures in their own everyday lives.
Thank you for that response, and I'm really heartened to hear that the Barriers to Elected Office Committee has reconvened, and look forward to hearing what they come up with. I'm now going to move on to questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. I just wanted to touch on the issue of female councillors voluntarily standing down after one or perhaps two terms, just to ask whether you or COSLA have any information, any data on this nationally. I mean, I know in my own local authority area, at the last election, five female councillors voluntarily stood down, and two of them were elected in by-elections, so they didn't even have a full five-year term, and that's a huge number for just one local authority. So just wondering if you've got any data on the position nationally.
Thanks for the question. I don't. I'll maybe refer to Alexis in a moment to see if she can update an accurate data. I mean, so just coming back into councils, into local government at this term, we've seen an increase from 29% to 35%. So there has been an increase in women coming into councils. But similar to yourself, I've experienced, you know, colleagues who had a massive amount of experience and talent to offer to the role, make that decision not to return in elections earlier this year, which, you know, is hugely disappointing. You know, these are, I think one of our last speakers spoke about the breadth of the role and how often you just come to that five-year end of term that you just begin to feel like you're understanding, you know, completely what is expected in the roles of councillors, starting to really get into your stride. It's really disappointing that the women who have previously stood for council and I'm sure been incredibly successful in their roles have made that decision not to stand. But again, I would just reiterate, you know, those pressures that people are facing, so remuneration, you know, reflecting in the current crisis that's affecting everybody's life, the workload when it comes to balancing childcare, you know, and the hours, and again, culture issues, I suppose, all of that just creates the perfect storm for certain women to make that decision not to stand for local authority elections.
Okay, thanks for that. I
mean, I was just going to check with Alexis to see if she has any more data.
Yeah, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Morrison, and good morning, committee. I'd just like to really reiterate what Councillor Morrison has said around the financial pressures, particularly faced by female councillors, and the impact that has on their decision not to seek re-election. It's something that came out very strongly from our survey of councillors that we undertook last year around workload, where in an open text question asking for councillors' views about financial barriers, there was an overwhelming response from female councillors saying that pressure of the low pay that councillors currently receive and the pressures of having to balance a second job with childcare have led to them deciding not to re-stand. This survey was undertaken before the 2022 elections. All but one of the comments were either from women stating that they're not standing for re-election because of remuneration, with one being from a male councillor talking about a female councillor, female colleague of his who'd already stood down before the election, citing financial pressures as, you know, as the reason for not being able to continue in the role.
Thanks for that. touch briefly earlier, Councillor Morrison, on the way that the role of a councillor has changed and the range of responsibilities and the burdens that has changed over the past 15 years. I wonder if you're able to expand on that and reflect on that, and given that context, whether it's even remotely sustainable for councillors to continue on the current levels of pay they are, given the changes to the role over the last 15 years.
Thank you. It's a massive challenge. You know, I think our evidence documents the fact that many councillors currently hold two jobs because the remuneration just isn't adequate to meet the current standard of living. So, you know, me myself, in my last term, I balanced two jobs with great difficulty, but that's out of necessity. The role itself, within an administration of a local authority, and again, there'll be lots of experience around the table, is incredibly demanding, continue to be incredibly demanding over the period of the intensity of the pandemic. The reactive practice that was needed just to ensure that services were continuing to deliver as they should have been for our communities now. Incredibly fastly paced way of working was hugely demanding for officers, for local elected members as well. So often we're finding senior members of councils are doing 50 hours plus, and that time is spent, as I've said previously, between, you know, those sort of strategic responsibilities and as well as balancing, you know, our work within communities, which again is absolutely, you know, where we need to be seen and be visible so that we can ensure we're representing our communities as best as we can. Often that is really, really challenging. Those late hours, finding childcare, balancing, you know, all those responsibilities that you have at home with ensuring that your community is represented as best as it can be, it's extremely demanding. There's no sight to those responsibilities diminishing in any way. In fact, it just feels like we're in a very intense time, and that the workload of local councillors will only increase as we go forward. So, I don't feel that the remuneration is adequate at the moment. And I think we really should be focused on allowing councillors to focus on being a local elected member in its own right, and not having to be in a situation where a second job is required.
Okay, thanks, Kavina. And just finally, we've talked about cultural barriers, financial barriers, and I just wanted to touch on legal barriers as well. We know that there's a disqualification for those who work for a local authority to stand for election. There are disqualifications around bankruptcy and other things, and I'm just wondering whether these disqualifications are appropriate at all, given the context that we live in of, you know, the cost of living crisis and interest rates shooting through the roof, potentially councillors becoming bankrupt because of the levels of remuneration. Why should that be a disqualification for someone who has that lived experience to become a councillor? Why should someone who has the experience of working in, say, a social care setting be disqualified from becoming a councillor, where someone perhaps who provides it in the independent sector and is contracted by a council can stand for council? And we see, you know, particularly in the Central Belt, councillors working for local authorities that are perhaps right next door, but it's much more difficult to do in island or more rural communities. So just your views on some of the legal disqualifications that there are on standing for a councillor, and whether you think they're appropriate, given I think the legislation was set out in the 1970s.
I suppose I would comment on the inclusion or the ability of local authority staff to stand for local election. And, you know, that would be, it is fairly disappointing, especially considering that likes of Murray, you know, we're a major employer in the authority, as well as having a heavily weighted female percentage within our employees. So it is disappointing that you were unable to attract people, or people are unable to stand for local election if they are employees of the council, because like you say, that lived experience is absolutely vital when it comes to fulfilling the role as an elected member and representing our communities. So yes, that is disappointing. You know, we also face a challenge where we're asking people who perhaps hold a job within a local authority, would they like to stand for an election? And these are people who, you know, potentially will have to give up their job. So for perhaps a lower pay. So it is a huge commitment, and it's a huge leap for people to make. People still do it, but it's a huge risk. Because also there's no assurance that they will be elected into office. So, yes, that poses significant challenges.
Thanks, Gavina.
Thanks, Mark. And we're now going to move to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Just touch on my question, the culture and working environment of local councils was cited as a reason why some female councillors decided to stand down. And having experienced sexual harassment myself as a young female councillor and receiving no help when I called out my male group leader, I get why some women feel unsupported in that misogynistic environment, and it can be a reason why they sort of choose to stand down. What more can the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government do to improve that situation?
Thank you. I mean, sorry to hear about your experiences. I think that, you know, reflects my experience of again, anecdotally talking to my colleagues and what they've gone through within the council, incredibly challenging situations, and unfortunately not a reporting mechanism that's particularly helpful in any way for majority of this kind of experience. So I think, you know, absolutely ensuring that when people, women within elected office are experiencing any sort of behaviour like you've described, that there is a safe reporting mechanism in place that they can gain assurance and safety through. At present, you know, we have a system where more often than not, the reporting mechanism that's often referred to by colleagues is Standards Commission, and albeit it fulfills an extremely important function, often the nuances of certain admissions to the Standards Commission are perhaps don't particularly capture, you know, the correct sort of layout, you know, that they can respond to. So you often find women councillors are just left in a position where they feel, you know, unrepresented, and they feel extremely vulnerable. So I think there's a lot of work to be done, there to, you know, to learn from one another and just make sure that women, fundamentally, we should be able to provide a safe working environment for local councillors.
Thank you. Staying on the sort of safety aspect, Cause of Submission obviously highlights efforts been made to improve the safety of councillors. What evidence is there that there's a particular concern for female councillors, and what more can be done to ensure councillors feel safe carrying their duties? I don't know if Alexis wants to answer that one, or even yourself.
I can start off. We've certainly done you know, there's been several cases recently where councillors have had quite horrific attacks and threats against them. So there has been work done with Police Scotland, certainly with a new cohort of councillors that came in May. Sessions have been run online with Police Scotland just around, you know, safety for specifically lone working. And that's something that certainly when I came into the role, having previously been a mental health nurse, very aware of, just ensuring that colleagues weren't left in very vulnerable positions, but often it was supporting one another rather again than those real formal mechanisms being in place. So I think that we're certainly making good progress with ensuring that that's an area where local authorities are having to absolute, you know, laser focus on to, and feedback from colleagues who have taken part in the online sessions has been really has been really welcomed. I'll pass over to Alexis.
Thank you, Councillor Morrison. One thing that I would point to in terms of COSLA's work in this area is the work that we've done with the other local government associations across the UK, so local government associations for England, Wales and Northern Ireland, under the umbrella of Civility and Public Life, which is work that was started in 2020 with a joint statement from our then President, Councillor Everson, along with her equivalents in the three other nations. And through this work, it's been very clear that it is female councillors that experience online abuse and harassment, you know, in particular. And so as part of this work with the previous Barriers to Elected Office Special Interest Group, we developed with the other three nations resources around digital citizenship, infographics for councillors to use on their social media, to set rules of engagement and advice about how to report incidents and how to address these incidents. And just to pick up on what Councillor Morrison has said around this sort of physical safety aspect, we have a very good working relationship with Police Scotland, which really developed in terms of councillor safety following the tragic murder of Sir David Ames MP in October 2021. And that's been an ongoing relationship where Police Scotland have really tried to understand the nuances of the councillor role and the fact that, as Councillor Morrison has said, it's a lone working role, and particularly female councillors may feel vulnerable having surgeries late at night, you know, without staff in the way that an MSP or an MP would have at their surgery. And the feedback that we've had from elected members following the latest round of safety briefings from Police Scotland has been incredibly positive. And councillors have been provided with their local area command and divisional contact in each area. Each briefing was delivered aimed at specific areas of Scotland, so relevant divisional police staff could be there to make sure those relationships with local police staff are developed, you know, to continue this work.
My questions, thanks. Convener.
Thanks. Thank you, Marie. I just wanted to come back, Shona, and ask a question. It's connected to culture and maybe a simpler one to answer. I just wonder, when you talk about these long hours that people have to work and you know, the lack of balance with the remuneration, but maybe something could be done to change the long working hours. So who has the power to change the working hours in a council for the councillors? Where does that sit?
I think it depends really on the role that you fulfil within a council. So in opposition, although you still have the same amount of committees, etc., you know, there's the demands on your time are slightly less as a councillor in an administration. You have also, along with committees, you have you know, regular meeting with officers, etc. So, you know, that's that absolutely, you know, is part and parcel of the role. The community meetings, again, you know, that's vital that, you know, as much as possible, you know, you're able to attend. There is those long hours, and I'm sure, again, you know, we've got experience around the table of council meetings. Council meetings can go on quite a long time, so often it's a responsibility of the chair to ensure that councillors are being concise in their questioning and discussions, and that sometimes doesn't happen. So, you know, there's a responsibility to speak to each other as colleagues. I think it's incredibly important to make people aware. You know, we've also had colleagues who have physical issues with attending long meetings. So again, that ability to use digital technology has been really welcomed, certainly within our own authority, and I hear that from colleagues as well. So that time away from the desk, you know, stretching your legs, being able to eat something to get a drink, you know, that makes a huge difference. So, you know, there is a responsibility, I think, on individual councils to ensure that the business, and certainly that's something that my own council is looking at the moment, that is carried out in a way that it's, you know, that we're making sure that all our businesses is appropriately carried out, but that is done so in a way that is that recognises the pressure on people's times. But I do think that, you know, there is there are challenges there that I think nationally we could all learn from one another as to how we ensure that business is conducted in a way that recognises the pressure on individuals' workload.
Thanks very much for that. Something about managing agendas, which I'm busy doing this morning. So I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with a couple of questions.
Right, thanks, convener. Good morning, Councillor Morrison and Alexis and this panel. I just wanted to continue with the same theme I asked the previous panel. I don't know whether you were tuned into that. It was really about support mechanisms that might be in place to assist their elected members, particularly female elected members, to participate and do their job well and hopefully stay within the councils. A couple of suggestions were more support on admin and casework. As you know, MSPs, MPs have a budget to allow us to do that, but in my memory, it's very, very limited to allow elected members, councillors, to have that same level of support to conduct casework. The hybrid working model is one that we're all aware of, was really beneficial to all elected members and the parliaments and the local councils. So I just wanted to get a few thoughts from yourself, Councillor Morrison, about what support mechanisms might look like and whether COSLA is intending to pursue these over the current term that you're in.
Thanks for the questions. I'll just maybe touch on the hybrid stuff first. So whilst, you know, we really welcome the ability to hold hybrid meetings following on and during the pandemic when that became just a normal way of working. What, again, anecdotally, what I'm now finding and colleagues are finding is that as we people become more relaxed about going back into arenas where, you know, you're in close contact with others, is that there's a slight push from local authorities to perhaps have an expectation that people are there in person rather than online, which is posing quite a few difficulties, as you can imagine. So we have several disabled members within our council who really do feel that they're experience is limited because of that. So attending online meetings digitally for them, but then being faced with a chamber full of their colleagues, so missing a lot of that. And these are, you know, new members, so missing a lot of that, you know, just softer, I suppose, exposure to colleagues where you build those kind of really important relationships. So whilst I absolutely, and, you know, for myself, I have to travel 3.5 hours to get to Edinburgh, so I, you know, I hugely appreciate the benefits of online meetings. I think, you know, certainly COSLA, we're very aware of ensuring that there's equity for councillors in amongst that, and that nobody feels at a disadvantage, because that would be hugely, hugely frustrating. And I know a lot of our certainly my own council, our members that have been elected in May, disabled members, again, really benefited from the funding for a banished elected office. Obviously, that since has kind of left a little bit of a vacuum, so that really the emphasis now on member support, and that's often, you know, through no fault of anybody's, it's just sort of lack of exposure. So I'm aware that some very good work's been done in Scottish Government, so really keen that the local authorities learn from that practice. With regards to sort of those culture and workload issues, yes, absolutely agree, having worked myself from an MSP, that the huge benefit to have, you know, that ability to draw on all your staff and all the expertise that they bring and can offer to support. So absolutely, is, you know, you're constantly juggling multiple responsibilities, both locally and nationally. So yes, absolutely agree that that would be a focus going forward with the reconvening the Special Interest Group for the Barriers to Elected Office. They'll be looking at how do we support our councillors and our local authorities to manage that casework and other responsibilities.
Aye, thanks for that. Have you had any time to consider whether all of Scotland's authorities are still embracing the digital hybrid model quite well, or have some retreated back to more towards in person?
As we retreat back into our comfy silos, I'm not entirely sure. I don't have that data to hand, but that's certainly, you know, questions we can ask and we can sort of pull out some data there. But, you know, our own experiences from COSLA meetings, we have done one hybrid meeting so far, the rest have been online. And we probably found about 30% of leaders attended in person and the rest were online. So there's still that nice balance. But yes, just very aware. And again, that's something that we'll be focused on in the reconvened special interest group, about ensuring that nobody feels at a disadvantage, that there is equity for all members.
Okay, great. And another question I had that you might have heard in the previous panel again, we were interested in the numbers of female councillors, in particular from ethnic minority backgrounds, and the previous panel weren't able to provide any hard and fast statistics or data about that. Councillor Morrison, is that something that COSLA might take up and be able to report, a breakdown of female councillors from ethnic backgrounds and so on, to inform the work that this committee is doing?
You know, that incredibly important. So I think, and I would just make the same, I suppose, references as the past speakers to the Scottish Government Elections Team and the survey that they've collated and will be publishing shortly. I mean, that will be, I suppose, welcomed by COSLA as providing excellent data with regards to the elections and the shifts within our demographics of our newly elected members.
Okay. Many thanks for that. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I just wanted to pick up on the support aspect, and I wondered, Shona, if you've got any thoughts about what this, whether the Scottish Government has a role in helping or encouraging council to provide more support.
Not at present I'm aware of, but I might, you know, I'll again perhaps defer to Alexis in a moment if that's all right. What I would say is that we do meet regularly, monthly, with Mr. McPherson in his role as Minister for Social Security and Local Government. So that's absolutely a space that we're able to have those conversations, and I assume that will also inform part of their discussion in the SLARC Board, Scottish Local Authorities Remuneration Committee, rather, that is due to take place. I think at the moment they are just trying to, or they've advertised to populate the committee, and hoping for their report to be published by August 2023. So and COSLA sit within that committee and the population of the committee. So I would assume that would be an area that we would be asking them to pursue.
Thanks very much for that. And I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs with a question.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us this morning. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to barriers for disabled members seeking office and what happens when they do gain elected office. And I'm sure you're both aware of the quite high profile case here in Edinburgh of a newly elected disabled member who highlighted the lack of support accessibility and, I think, to be quite honest, basic workplace health and safety advice which was given. Just wondered what conversations have taken place within COSLA to make sure that this changes. You know, the fact that this situation arose in the first place, I don't think is acceptable. And then following on, my question was with regards to the Access to Elected Office Fund, what positive impact do you think that's made?
Thank you. Thanks. And again, I'll maybe ask Alexis to pick up on a couple of points. Having spoken to a few of our newly elected councillors who have benefited from the fund, I think it was a huge benefit just to be able to have that support there. Really allowed them, I think, during campaigns and what have you, to feel incredibly supported. But unfortunately, as I've highlighted, we've now found with that sort of almost, you know, cliff edge from having that support in place to now being a newly elected member, that, you know, certain issues have certainly been, you know, I've had those conversations with colleagues. And again, it's about just that lack of awareness, or no, sorry, that's probably not the right word, just that lack of member services having had, you know, just that time to adapt and space, and also just to gather sort of learning experience from other authorities in Scottish Government. And like you said, Mr. Briggs, there's been some fantastic work carried out in Scottish Government, and I really hope that we can reflect that good practice within COSLA. And I'll maybe defer to Alexis to see if she has anything else she'd like to add.
Thank you, Councillor Morrison. I would like to pick up on the first question, Mr. Briggs, about the lack of support for a newly elected disabled member. It's something, the concerns around support and the sort of knowledge and experience within member services departments in councils to support disabled elected members, was something that was raised as part of the work of the previous Barriers to Elected Office Special Interest Group. And one of the pieces of work that I undertook after the group disbanded at the end of the previous local government term, was speaking to member services departments within councils across Scotland. And a clear message came out from my conversations that actually there isn't the skills around understanding how to assess the needs of an individual in terms of what somebody might need to help them to access, access their role and be fully included in their role, isn't necessarily there within those teams in the way that it was very much embedded in a local authority's HR department because of the responsibilities around making reasonable adjustments for employees. What we would say from COSLA's point of view is that although obviously a councillor doesn't have employee status, they need to be able to do their job and be supported to access what they need to do their job from the first day of being elected. And there's definitely work that can be done, and something that Councillor Morris and I will, you know, can discuss in terms of future work for the hopefully newly reconvened special interest group around what advice and support is given to local authorities to ensure that member services departments have the skills and experience and can draw on knowledge from their human resources departments to make sure that they understand how to make reasonable adjustments, where to access sources of support, because the burden, I think, sometimes falls on an elected member to know what they need in order to do the job of a councillor. But if you haven't been a councillor before, you're relying on council staff to sort of assess your needs and suggest adjustments that might need to be made, or equipment, or, you know, those of access issues. One other thing I would like to point out is the conversation that I had over the summer with staff at the Scottish Parliament about their experience of making sure that the Parliament is an accessible and inclusive place for their disabled elected members. And as Councillor Morrison has already said, there's a lot of learning, I think, that local authorities can take, and, you know, COSLA obviously has a role in that, in taking that to local authorities, from the Parliament to make sure that, you know, accessibility is, you know, not just something that is, you know, fully experienced by elected members in a particular sphere of our political system.
Thank you for that. That's very helpful. And I think, you know, like you say, here in Parliament, we have a framework which is available. I imagine local authorities were following that as well. So disappointed that that's not been the case. Just finally, I wanted to ask with regards to that very issue you touched upon in terms of member support groups. Do you see a difference in sizes of councils and councillors which are then being supported within councils, and what services are being provided? And is that something which, you know, with each council setting different rules, different rates, having different systems in place to support their elected members, needs to be more sort of a national standard provided, basically, so that people can expect, you know, I know from my own Conservative colleagues who have joined different councils, just how surprised they've been at the lack of secretarial support in some areas, whereas in other councils, they've been very pleased with that. And so I just wondered if that was something you would also like to see, and something which needs to be pursued.
I think there's always a need for ensuring that we have a really coordinated approach to what we can offer members throughout Scotland. So absolutely, and you know, I would suggest that that reconvening a special interest group absolutely will focus on, you know, where we're seeing extremely good practice, what we can learn from colleagues, whether that's in local authority or a Scottish Government, and replicate the same, so we have that standard, so that we can give people assurance that whether they're in a council in Shetland or in Moray or at Aberdeen City or Edinburgh, that they will have and should have the same experience and the same access as other colleagues do.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much. So thanks so much for that. We've come to the end of our questions. It's been very, very helpful. Really appreciate you joining us this morning, Councillor Morrison and Alexis. Your evidence has been very useful. And I look forward to other times when you will join us. But as we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the remaining items on our agenda in private, I now close the public part of the meeting.